Hi students, a very warm welcome to all of you. Today we are going to start a chapter of 12th science biology, that is sexual reproduction in flowering plants. Right? Among all the plants, the angiosperms are very specialized plants, right? Because they are the only plants in which specialized reproductive structures are developed, and those structures are called as flower. The flowers are specialized reproductive structures developed only in the angiosperm plants, which are cosmopolitan in nature. They are present everywhere, and they are the specialized plants among all the plants, as they are producing a specialized reproductive structures called flower. Now, what is exactly the flower? How can we define? The flower is actually a modified shoot. That means a tip of the branch of a shoot system is modified into a flower. First, it will develop as a bud, then it develops as a shoot. And this shoot will going as a bud, and then bud will going to develop as a flower. Okay. So this is a reproductive part of an angiosperm plant, the most important part of angiosperms. Now, if you see, observe here, this is a figure of LS section, the longitudinal section of angiosperm flower. Right? Longitudinal section of angiosperm flower. In this flower, there are two types of structures we can observe. The first is a non-reproductive parts, they are sterile in nature, and second one, reproductive parts, they are actually a fertile parts of a plant, or we can say the flower. Right? The non-reproductive parts are two types, that is, these are the sepals and petals. The outermost roll of flower is called sepal. The roll of sepal is called as calyx, and the colorful part of a flower is a petals. That is, the roll of petal is called corolla. So this calyx and corolla are considered as a non-reproductive parts of a flower. In the reproductive parts, we can observe the two important parts. That is, one is belongs to the male reproductive part, and second one is belongs to the female reproductive part. Right? The male reproductive part is called androecium, and the female reproductive part is called gynoecium. These are the two important reproductive parts are there. Apart from all these essential and non-essential parts, or we can say the reproductive and non-reproductive parts are placed on one place, that is called a thalamus. Thalamus is a place on which all these reproductive and non-reproductive parts are placed. And this thalamus continues as a pedicel. Pedicel is a stalk of flower, right? If the pedicel is present, that is called pedicellate flower. If the pedicel is absent, those flowers are called as sessile flowers, right? We already discussed about all these things, that is in the morphology of flowering plants of a chapter 5 of 11th standard, right? Now we'll move to the androecium. Now what is androecium? It is a male reproductive part. This androecium consists of stamens, right? The androecium consists of stamen. Now, what is exactly the stamen, right? The stamens are the male reproductive parts, that includes androecium, which consists two important parts. If you see here in the diagram, the anther and the filaments, both anther and filament are together considered as a stamen. That means each stamen, this is a male reproductive structure which consists anther and the filament. Anther is a lobed structure present on the tip of filament, that is a distal part of filament, and the proximal part of filament attached to the thalamus, or sometimes it attached to the petals, right? These are the androecium. There is a gynoecium, there is a female reproductive part. It consists of three important parts. That is, the first is a stigma, second is a style, and third is a ovary. stigma, style and ovary, all three together called pistil. So pistil is a female reproductive part that includes gynoecium, and the stamen is a male reproductive part. Okay. Now, we'll discuss about the androecium. Now, what is androecium? As we discussed, that is a, it consists of stamen, and each stamen is consist of two things, that is anther and filament. Filament is a stalk. The distal part of filament consists of anther. Now, in most of the angiosperm plant, as we are discussing about the flowering plants, the angiosperm, in most of the angiosperm plants, the anther is always considered as bilobed dithecous anther. The anther is considered as bilobed dithecous anther. Most of the angiosperm plant having this kind of anthers. Now, what is the meaning of bilobed dithecous anther? Here, a figure is given, anther and filament. This is the anther part and this is the filament part. Now, if you observe, this filament is a stalk. Right, on the distal part of filament, the two lobes are there. The left and right lobes are there. That means each anther is composed of two lobes. When the two lobes are there, these two lobes are together called as bilobed. So it is a bilobed anther. Right? It is a bilobed anther. When we cut this anther as a transfer section. Here is a transfer section of anther is given. When we cut this anther as a transfer section, we'll get a slide of this pattern. If you observe here, this is the left side lobe and this is the right side lobe. The two lobes are there, right? From my side, this is the right side and this is the left side lobe. So, right and left lobes are there, and each lobe further divides into two chambers. In this lobe, the two chambers are there, and in this lobe also two chambers are there, and each chamber is considered as theca. Each chamber is considered as a theca. So, how many thecas are there? There are four thecas are there that were distributed in two different lobes. So it is already denoted as bilobed and dithecous. Dithecous means in bilobed anther, each lobe consists of two thecas. Each lobe consists of two thecas. That is called dithecous. So this structure of anther can be defined as bilobed dithecous anther. That means the anther is consists of two lobes and each lobe consists two chambers, that is called theca. So it is denoted as bilobed dithecous anther. So overall, how many thecas are there? Four thecas are there, and each theca, and in each theca there is a most important structure is present called microsporangium. Microsporangium. So as we know, there are four thecas are there. They have four microsporangiums, and when it is a consists of four microsporangiums, this type of anther is considered as tetrasporangiate anther. This type of anther is considered as tetrasporangiate anther. So, it is a tetrasporangiate anther. Okay. So, anther is a bilobed dithecous and tetrasporangiate. So, it is a completed description about this anther. And it is connected with the distal part of filament with a tissue called connective tissue. Right. So, now we'll discuss about the microsporangium. right? So now this is the diagram of ultrastructure of microsporangium, right? It's a microscopic structure. We have taken this structure like this portion. We have taken this portion, the whole portion. That means we have taken the one theca of here. It's a magnified part of one theca. Now if you observe this, in this section, this microsporangium, it is a microsporangium, it is covered by four important layers. Each microsporangium is covered by four important layers, right? From outer side to inner side, if you observe, the first is a epidermis, the first outermost layer. Second is the endothecium. Third one is the middle layer. Several middle layers are there. The fourth one, the most important one, trapezium. This is the fourth one. This is the third one. This is the second one. This is the first. Okay? So, the tetrasporangiate diathecous bilobed anther, and each microsporangium is covered by four different layers. From outer side to inner side, the first layer is called as epidermis, second is called as endothecium, third are several middle layers, and fourth one trapezium, and inside the trapezium, the tissue is called sporogenous tissue. The tissue present inside the microsporangium is called sporogenous tissue. This is the structure. Now, what exactly is the epidermis? Epidermis is a outermost protective layer. Right? Epidermis is a outermost protective layer. It is a unicellular layer. The single cell only. So it is well differentiated outer protective layer, epidermis. Below the epidermis, the next layer is called endothecium. It is the second most layer. This endothecium is the most important layer. It is also a unicellular layer. It is hygroscopic in nature. Right? It is hygroscopic in nature. It is able to absorb the water. And the most important function of endothecium is dehiscence of anther. Right? The most important function is dehiscence of anther. Now, what is the meaning of dehiscence? First, after the maturation of this anther, that means, what is the meaning of actually the maturation and what is the function of this anther? Inside the anther, most important process takes place, that is microsporogenesis and development of male gametophytes, that is pollen grains. So pollen grains will develop inside this sporogenous tissue only. So when the pollen grains are completely developed, that is called the matured condition of anther, and this anther will get burst. That is the dehiscence. The dehiscence of this particular anther is under the control of this particular layer called endothecium. Right? So this endothecium particularly dehisces the anther at this part. That is, these are called grooves. These are the grooves. At this part, the cells of endothecium get burst and anther will just dehiscence and all the pollen grains released from this sporangium. So this is the most important layer for the dehiscence of anther. Now below the endothecium, there are several middle layers are there. Right? These are several layers. 2 to 3 layers are there. Unicellular layers. Middle layers are called as they are responsible for the storage of food materials, which derived by endothecium. Now the below the middle layers, the most important layer or innermost layer of microsporangium called tapetum. The tapetum is the most important layer. Now, what is the use of this tapetum? Right? What is the use of this tapetum? This tapetum is perform the most important functions. Tapetum. This is the innermost layer. Right? It is a, it consists multinucleate cells. That means syncytium. Because of this multinucleate condition, it shows, right? Multinucleate condition, more than one nucleus, it shows polyploidy. Right? And this multinucleate or polyploidy is the condition because of the endomitosis. Endomitosis is nothing but the division of chromosomes which are not followed by the cytokines. That's why the nucleus, inside the nucleus, the polyploidy will occur, more number of chromosomes will present, and it is a multinucleate condition. They have very dense cytoplasm. They have very dense cytoplasm. Right? And what is the function of this tapetum? This tapetum will perform two important functions. The first is nourishment. Right? Nourishment of microspores and pollen grain, and second, synthesis of sporopollen. Nourishment of microspores and pollen grain. That means the microspores produced in the sporogenous tissue inside the microsporangium by process of microsporogenesis, and these microspores will further going to develop as a pollen grains. Right? So during this process, all these microspores and pollen grains derive the nutrition from this layer. That layer is tapetum. And during the development of pollen grains, it also helps in the synthesis of sporopollen, which is the most important, hardest substance present in the outer wall of pollen grains, right? Which gives a very resistant power against abnormal, unfavorable conditions. So, pollen grains will survive in the unfavorable conditions to face them, okay? So, these unfavorable conditions are the resistant power of pollen grains is about the sporopollen, and this sporopollen only synthesized from the tapetal cells. So, we discuss about the sporopollen in the structure of pollen grain, right, later. So, here the tapetum cells responsible for two important things. One is nourishment of microspores and pollen grains, and they are also responsible for the synthesis of sporopollen. These are the four important layers of microsporangium. And the anther is defined as bilobed dithecus tetrasporangiate. Okay, it's the most important thing. And each microsporangium consists of four important layers. And epidermis is the outermost. Second is the endothecium. Third, several middle layers. And fourth, tapetum. Okay, so this is about the structure of LS of flower, the part of androecium, the structure of anther, and the structure of microsporangium. Okay? Thank you.